أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفر ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله In the name of Allah, the most gracious and the most merciful, all the praise and glory belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him. We seek His guidance and ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the sins and evils of our souls. Whom Allah guides, no one can lead astray. Who Allah leads astray will not find guidance. I bear witness, there is no God but Allah. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his prophet and his messenger, the last of the prophets.
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu taqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun.
O you who believe, be conscious of Allah and do not die except as believers.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا قوامين لله شهداء بالقسط ولا يجرمنكم سنآن قوم على ألا تعدلوا يعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون
O you who believe, stand firmly with Allah as witness to fair dealings, and let not hatred of others make you to commit wrong and move away from justice. Be just, that is next to piety, and fear Allah, for Allah is well aware of what you do. Dear brothers and sisters, the topic for my khutbah today is building an inclusive community and contributing to a benevolent society. Before I get to my topic, I want to give you the genesis for this topic. On a beautiful Saturday morning, I was sitting in my coffee table with a cup of tea and a cell phone. As I was browsing through my email and WhatsApp messages, I came across an interesting article in the Harvard Business Review that caught my attention. The title of the article was, If You Want to Be Happy at Work, Have a Life Outside of It. If you want to be happy at work, have a life outside of it. For those who think that work is everything, you know, you might want to check this out. Wow. It almost sounded like the Quranic concept of وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ Believe and do righteous deeds. And essentially, the author of this article did research a few thousand people over a period of a few weeks to understand their emotions, what makes them happy, what makes them not happy. And the gist of the article is summarized in the last paragraph is this. If you want, the people who are happy are those that have a life outside of work, and more importantly, have the money to afford it. If you have a job that grants you both of these, you might be happier than you realize. This was done by authors of a company called Happify. You can go to this website, happify.com. And essentially, they try to understand the human traits that actually uplift the human beings. And essentially, they came out with six things, six characters. And if you were to search the Quran, if I tell you what it is, if you were to search the Quran for the six characters, you will probably come up with the same six things. The six traits that uplift a soul are gratitude, hope, compassion, purpose, empathy, optimism, and self-confidence. And I bet I want to reflect a little bit on self-confidence because this is some really important at this time. Self-confidence is about having the courage and conviction even when others doubt it. Let's not confuse self-confidence with arrogance, because it can take it to that. And we see a lot of that today, particularly coming up with the people in Washington, D.C. A word about courage. Courage is not about not having fear. Courage is not lack of fear. Courage is having that moral fortitude to overcome fear. Courage is having that moral fortitude to overcome fear. I always thought I will make a case for activism based on Quran, based on morality and spirituality. Never would I have thought I would make a case for it from an article in Harvard Business Review. If we were to summarize all of the six characters, and then I think, what is that all of this boiled down to in the context of the world we live in today? I came up with this topic: building an inclusive community and contributing to a benevolent society. If you think it is complicated, I'm going to delve into it. First, building an inclusive community. In any community, you have multiple constituents. There are those that want to come to the masjid on a regular basis for spirituality, for regular prayers, because that's what they grew up with. There are those that look to the masjid as a place to renew their activism. There are those that come to the masjid because they want to engage in social activities. So when you came, if you came to the food festival last week, you would have found a lot of people who showed up who normally you may not see them, because that's what they connected with. And then there's another set of constituents. These are our women, our youth, the refugees, the converts. So you have multiple constituents. The question is that, are we building a community that each of these constituents feel it is their own? You may ask, hey, there is no sign that says that only such and such people are welcome. That is not the point. A bee comes to a flower with nectars. Are we creating an environment that allows all of these constituents to be part of the community, to be part of the masjid? The second part of the topic is about contributing to a benevolent society. The first one is sort of internally focused, and the second one is externally focused. I don't think we can separate one at the expense of other. We cannot be a community that's completely internally focused, nor can be one that is purely externally focused. Contributing a benevolent community society, it is the role that we want to play in the larger society that we live in. Do you want to be beneficiaries, or do you want to be contributors to the society? So let me go to both of them. We'll talk with the first one, building an inclusive community. And I will try to make this in the context of this our community as much as possible, so that you can relate to what is happening and the issues that we face. First, I thought, when you think about inclusive community, of course you are inclusive community. This is what we have been talking about from the get-go. You can look at the depth of the breadth of programs that we have. In fact, for me, a very quantifiable barometer of an inclusive community is looking at the newsletter to see, do we have programs that engage each of these constituents? And if you go back 10 years ago and look at these, the programs, and look at today, we can see that evolution of inclusiveness. But then I got a bit of a rude awakening. I was in a social gathering not too long ago with a diverse ethnic group. And a dear friend was passionately saying, I would love for my daughter to come to the masjid, but because she does not wear hijab, she felt she was not a welcome member of the community, and she stopped coming to the masjid. Then I probed in, is it an isolated incident? Or is this a broader phenomena perhaps you are not aware of? And then there were a bunch of sisters that were sitting there, and they said, I come to the masjid regularly, I wear hijab, but I get very often comments from other sisters who perhaps may not agree with what the way their dresses, they're dressed. And so essentially, we do have issues that we have to address, and these are accentuated in our community because we are by far the most diverse community that has ever existed in the Muslim history. And if you want to look at empirically, ISPU, an organization, like a Pew Research, that made a research of different religious communities, and Muslims are the most diverse community today in America. So I was pondering about this, listening to a lecture from Dr. Sherman Jackson as in preparation for this khutbah that addressed this topic. And his advice was that, let us not engage in a gotcha Islam. He calls it a gotcha Islam, or a punitive mode of Islam, where we're too focused on finding the faults of others and quickly pointing out the faults of others. And he gave a good example from the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, where a man came to the masjid, and after the prayer, he approached the Prophet ﷺ and said, I committed a sin, and I need you to tell me what the punishment is so that I can be atoned for it. Prophet ﷺ listened to him and said, did you not pray with us? Yes, I did. Your sins are forgiven. The two interesting things for me was that, first of all, Prophet never even asked him what his sin was. And number two, the man who committed a sin had the moral fortitude to come to the mosque, talk to the Prophet, and tell him that he committed a sin. The question we have to ask ourselves is that, are we cultivating an environment in which people who feel like they have made a mistake are welcome to come and grow in spirituality before being judged? When Prophet lived in Medina, he did not see himself as the leader of those who regularly came to the masjid. He engaged with all sorts of people. And when there were occasions that we see in the seerah that he felt anger, was when Ansar and Muhajir, the immigrants, and the people of Medina decided to engage in an argumentation with each other. When the Muslims went into a fighting with the Jews, engaging in argumentation based on religious lines or ethnic lines. We all know of a woman who committed adultery and came to the Prophet ﷺ. In this example, this woman insisted on being punished. Even the Prophet found many, many ways for this woman to find a way out of this. When at the end, you know, she had her punishment, and after that, when Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu was making a mockery of him, Prophet warned him not to say anything about that person. So he even treated the hypocrites with respect and dignity. We all know the case of Abdullah ibn Ubay, the chief of the hypocrites. When he died, his son came to him and said, can you give me your shirt so that I can shroud my father's body with Prophet's shirt? And then Prophet asked him, I will come and lead the funeral prayer, to which Umar radiallahu anhu took a strong stand against doing so, because he said, God, Prophet prohibited you from doing that. Prophet ﷺ said, I was given a choice. Perhaps he may not be forgiven, but I was given a choice, and he led the prayer. That's how he treated even the leader of the hypocrites. After which a verse was revealed that said, you no longer can lead the funeral prayer of the hypocrites. So let me be provocative and ask this question to us. Should Salman Rushdie walk through the front door of the mosque, how would we treat him? Are we going to drive him away? What would we say to him? In the early days of MAPS, Michael Medved, a conservative talk show host, approached us wanting to engage in a dialogue. And we refused to engage with him. In hindsight, it was not a good thing for us to do. In another example, Leslie Hazelton. Many of you may have heard his TED talk on Islam. She wrote a book about the Prophet. We wanted to have a lecture, a book review. Many people felt uncomfortable because we disagreed with some parts of what she wrote. So the question for us is, are we going to build an inclusive community that allows all of the people of different constituents of a community to be part of this? And here is an important reason why. In the same ISPU study that was done, found that those who attended the mosque once a week are more likely to volunteer, register to vote, participate in the elections. So if you thought mosques was a place people got spiritually connected, think again. They also get more activism by coming to the mosque. And what's more interesting is that if you look at the millennials, people who are born after 1980, this is the group that has the least affiliation to the religion. But if you look at within across all religious lines, but if you look within this group of millennials and look for those millennials who have come to the mosque, you find that they're more likely to be practicing Muslim than any other religious group. In fact, the percentage of millennials who associate with Islam is same as the general Muslim population. Should we then not make it a point to make sure that we create an inclusive environment? Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim alayhi wa sallam. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل. So in the first khutbah I talked about building an inclusive community. How do we make sure that the various constituents of the community feel that they are part of this community? And that it requires all of us to make changes and be conscious of the fact that we are building an inclusive community. In the second part of the khutbah, I'll talk about contributing to a benevolent society. What do I mean by that? And why is it important and why now? The question we have to ask ourselves is that, as an American Muslim community, what role do we want to play in the society? Of course, we want to be a positive force for good. And number two, we want to be addressing the needs of the weak and the vulnerable in the society. An important point to think about here is that when we think about servicing the weak and the vulnerable, be it is providing food for the hungry, home for the homeless, medical services, legal services, this is an important consideration we have to think about. Service that we offer should not be for political correctness. It must be based on a principled stand because we believe in it. It is what our deen teaches us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا نُطِعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْحِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدَ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. We feed you for the sake of Allah alone. We do not seek any reward, recognition, or thanks. In a beautiful hadith, Prophet ﷺ said, we are provided for you in accordance with how you view the weak in your society. In another different narration, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges a people by how they treat the vulnerable ones. In Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاوَةِ وَالْأَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْحَهُ. And keep your soul content with those who are perceived as weak, and keep your soul patient with those who are perceived as weak, but call on their Lord morning and evening, seeking His pleasure. We might feel a tremendous amount of pressure, Islamophobia that is being inflicted upon us. But I would say we live in good times and in bad times. We live in good times because of the immense focus that we have negatively on our Muslim community. On the good times because we are the recipient of so much goodwill that we've never seen, that we never expected. If we think that we are the most sort of persecuted group of people, if you read the American history, you find that African Americans, Native Americans, Japanese Americans, Chinese Americans faced far more persecution than we did. A lot of the rights that we enjoy from a civil rights perspective are a result of the struggles that Afro-American community did for this country. We have a challenge, but we should seize it as an opportunity. That's exactly what Prophet ﷺ faced in Hudaybiyah. He faced his own and the best of the best, almost revolting and challenging him. But he saw it as an opportunity to transform the community and bring much needed peace. The question then becomes, should we focus locally, given all of the challenges that is happening throughout the world? In pick any Muslim country, there are a plethora of problems. What should we do? In fact, it came into a perfect storm last week, the day there was a chemical attack in Syria. So I was here for the Maghrib prayer. And after the prayer, a dear friend, a very active activist brother, sort of lamented loud, what are we to do after we see these images of children and innocent people being gassed out in their countries? First, I would say that we have to remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not place a burden on us more than we can bear. Having said that, we cannot stay silent, but how do we deal with this local versus international? And then I reflected on it and came across Stephen Covey's 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, in which he said, we all have a circle of concern and a circle of influence. We end up focusing too much on the circle of concern, because it will be by definition a very big circle, and jumping from one problem to another, as opposed to thinking about our circle of influence. And most of the time, the circle of influence is really close to us. It's really local. You might say that, well, do we really have a lot of local problems? We are probably the prosperous country in the world today, the richest country. What problems do we have? If you look around, you will. And I was faced with a stark reality a few weeks ago when I took an Uber drive from my home to airport on a business trip. In this case, the driver happened to be someone, a refugee from East Africa. And I was talking to him. I learned that he was a single father. He comes to MAPS. He has 4 kids that he is raising He recently was laid off of his job, and so he's doing driving Uber and taking care of his four children. And he told me that he used to have his children come to the Quran class, and he could no longer afford it, and therefore he decided to pull them out and do it himself. While at the same time figuring out how he can drive. The question is, why is that we cannot figure out such problems that exist and be systematic in providing support? It turns out that we took care of this particular brother's problems, but the reality is that if I had not met this person in my Uber ride, I would not know. The question is that, are these problems that exist? If you really want to know if the problem exists, I highly encourage you to go on a trip with MCRC to one of the shelters and see for yourself the people that don't have a place to sleep. You would think that I had assumed that these people are lazy people that somehow don't want to do work, because after all, we have very low employment rate. But that's not the case. When you see these people who are going to the shelters, the normal people who faced misfortunes in their life, and they go to work every day, but they don't have a place to sleep. And therefore, they are in these shelters. Go see for yourself right in our neighborhood that these problems do exist. When you talk about contributing to the society, there's a lot we can learn from the seerah. First and foremost, from Prophet ﷺ did not see himself as the leader of the Muslims. He cared deeply about the society he lived in. When there was a drought, he made sure wells were dug to provide water for irrigation, and that was not just for Muslims. When there was need for green pastures, he made sure that there were gardens that were created that serve all of the community. Even the zakat at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and during the early periods were only spent on the people that lived there. We know of a famous example during the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, where when there was areas where there was enough wealth that there was nobody to give zakat to, it was only then that zakat money was transported to the treasury in Medina. So there were people, sahaba, who moved to the different parts of the world. They never shipped the zakat to where they came from. They lived and spent their zakat where they lived. If you think that we are the first one that we face this problem, I want to recollect to you the challenges the Catholic community faced. It's a lot we can learn. If we think we are being persecuted, they kind of had worst of this as well, not too long ago. So much so that when John F. Kennedy ran for a president as the first Catholic president, Irish Catholic president, and by the way, he's not the first Irish. Andrew Jackson was the first Irish president, but he happened to be the first Irish Catholic. The issue of religion was so much in the front that he had to confront it. And he said, I'm quoting him, "Are we going to admit to the world, worse still, are we going to admit to ourselves that one third of American people is forever barred from the White House?" And if you look at how they had to change and evolve their community, they did four things. First, they wanted to make sure that the refugees that came to America, and there's a lot of refugees coming from Europe, they wanted, and among them Catholics, they wanted to make sure that they rehabilitated the refugees as well as start influencing right from the time people came to their shores as to their view of Catholics. So they built Catholic rehabilitation programs. We know today them as Catholic Charities, the largest refugee rehabilitation program. Next, they built schools to make sure that when the children grow up, they realize that they're benefiting from the service that Catholic community is providing them, the best school system. In fact, the fact that there was a point in which religious schools were about to be banned through a constitutional amendment, they fought against it. The fact that we can have an Islamic school today is because of the struggles they did. Next, they built hospitals to make sure that they provide for the sick. And finally, they wanted to make sure that they had leadership that is natively grown So they built Jesuit universities wherein they can have the best of their best trained locally to meet the challenges of their community. There's a lot that we can learn. The point is that people are not moved by the rituals. People are moved by acts of kindness and genuineness. Ask anybody that has come through the mosque. The first impression they will have, and the lasting impression they will have, is how you treated them. Alex Cronemer, who came here not too long ago for the screening of the movie, The Sultan and the Saint, told of his own journey to Islam. And it was an act of kindness that he came to the mosque that made him connected to the faith, and then he started reading the Quran that he had. And if you look at the story behind Sultan and the Saint and how the Crusades came to an end, it is the contact between the Muslims and the Crusaders, the first ever real contact, that ultimately disended the whole centuries of fighting. Because they really saw the spirit of the Muslims. When the Crusaders, after having killed 80,000 Muslims, when they themselves found themselves being in a suffering because of the flooding of the Nile, and then the Muslims there decided to feed them, they thought, are these the guys we are fighting against? And even later on, when other popes decided to create 6th and 7th Crusades, there was no mass support because people didn't feel like they need to fight such nice people. And finally, I would say that we are overwhelmed by what we saw in the travel ban. People sacrificing. Here was a majority that went out to support the Muslims. If you remember, the ban came on a Friday night. Saturday morning, there were scores of people, elected officials, organizations, that went out. In fact, not 2 days ago, there was a front page article in Seattle Times about Northwest NWIRP, Northwest Immigration Rights Project. I encourage you to go read it, to get for yourself that all that happened just didn't happen out of sudden, out of luck. People were struggling to, on the day it happened, they could not find the names of people who were being detained or banned from entering because the Customs and Border Patrol would not give it to them. And for them to file a lawsuit, they got to have people. So people rushed and went to the baggage area to find Muslims who were stranded, from whom they can garner some information. And then they filed a lawsuit on their behalf and points out that there were two people that came on Emirates flight in the morning who, after 12 hours being shipped, they didn't even know who the names were. When they filed a lawsuit, they put John Doe 1 and John Doe 2. And the flight was about to leave the gate. They ran and really stopped the plane because they knew that judge was about to issue a stay order. It took a lot of people, a lot of sacrifice, and they did it because they didn't benefit anything out of it. They did it because they knew that they were vulnerable in the society they need to take care of. So we have an obligation. What is our role? When was the last time we supported one of these organizations? Do we think about it? When we see that there is a water crisis in Michigan, does it come to us that innate thing about we got to do something? After all, we live in this country. We got to think ourselves go beyond just internally focused to have an external focus. Think about when you do your zakat and sadaqah and charity, we got to evolve to a point where we think about a percentage of that really should go to the broader community, that society that we are part of, so that we take care of the ones that are nearby. Most of the people that actually eventually end up being big changes, they started their activism locally. Barack Obama started his career as an activist for a local church. Patty Murray first ran for a school board before she became a state senator. So we all have an opportunity to go from expand our circle of influence to a circle of concern, but you got to start with a circle of influence. And there are lots of things we can do. You got to think about your time, your money. And I want to end with thinking through the fact that we have, alhamdulillah, built up a community that is providing a lot of these services. Now, Abdul Salam was telling me that in the last 3 months alone, we have spent $75,000 helping the refugees, helping the needy. If 5 years ago, somebody wrote us a check for $75,000 to help the needy in the community, we would not even know how to do what to do. But alhamdulillah, because of the contributions of sacrifice of time, your money, your efforts, that we are expanding, we have a long way to go. As you think about it, there are many things that we can do. And one I would remind you is that in 2 weeks from now, we have a fundraiser for our mosque that help us to sustain these efforts. And if there is a first thing you can do before you leave masjid today, is commit yourself to coming. Think about the people that they left their families and went on a Saturday morning to go to the airport to find these people who are being banned from travel ban, who going through a travel ban. Think about, are you willing to give that Saturday evening to come and attend the event that help us to build strong organizations that help us to contribute to the society? There is MHS event, who are taking care of the refugees, that is happening today. And the CARE has a banquet. So I want us to think about this and finally conclude by saying that we have to build both an inclusive community that is internally focused as well as a contributing to the broader society in which we live in. And we do that by taking care of the weak and the vulnerable among us. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to what is good and help us to follow it. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless this community, alleviate the sufferings, and be of those who are the foremost in contributing to the great good of the community. We pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate all the sufferings of all the Muslims all over the world. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Nabiyyina Mawlana Muhammadin Mubarak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ahir da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Aqim as-salah.